afternoon, everybody. My name is Ignacio Alarcón. I'm Academic Senate President. Welcome to the 29th lecture at City College. Please turn off your cell phones. Each year, the faculty lecturer is elected based upon outstanding teaching, counseling, or librarianship, and dedicated service to the college community. And I hear that our lecturer this year walks on water or goes underwater, something like that. But I would like our past lecturer, marine biology professor Jenny Anderson, to introduce our speaker.
Thanks, Ignacio, very much. What an exciting day. I first met Don Barthelmess by phone during his interview for a position of Professor of Marine Technology here at Santa Barbara City College. I was a member of the selection committee, and I had my doubts about how telephone interviews could possibly give us an indication of what qualities we were looking for. But one of the candidates was offshore in Alaska during the time of the interview, so all of the interviews were conducted by phone. Well, Don's dynamic personality, extensive marine tech background, and excitement to teach at a community college came through the phone lines loud and clear. At the end of the telephone interview, I felt like I knew Don very well without ever having actually met him. And there was no question he was the top candidate for the position. Boy, were we lucky at City College here to have Don join our outstanding marine diving technology staff in 1989. His enthusiasm and ability to inspire others in marine topics was so evident on the phone during his interview, and even more so in person. This quality about Don continues to this day. Don has many extraordinary things that have happened to him in the marine tech industry, including setting several records in commercial diving. Too many for me to elucidate right now, but I encourage you to read about the lecture in your program for details of his numerous accomplishments. He brought all of these experiences, knowledge, and professionalism to his teaching, leading the Marine Tech Department to be honored as the California Community College Exemplary Program by the Chancellor's Office in 1998. Don has been a great colleague and active in college governance while balancing a life that he loves with friends and family and his beloved marine diving technology. Never afraid to conquer new fields, Don often wears many and varied hats all concurrently, including earning a graduate degree and the most recent one being the highest honor for an SBCC faculty member, the annual Faculty Lecturer Award. Let's welcome our 2007-2008 faculty lecturer, Don Barthelmess.
Oh, boy. Thank you. Wow. Thank you, Jenny. Gosh, she had a... I was sitting down there, and she had a lot of nice things to say, didn't she? Jenny, I was wondering, would it be possible to get a copy of that? I want to get it to my in-laws. No, they love me, and I love them dearly. Seriously, I am honored to be here today before so many friends, family, students, colleagues in our community. Not only is this a personal highlight in my career, but I'm actually very proud to represent the Vocational Education Division here at Santa Barbara City College. Thank you. Now, the roots of deep water commercial diving are firmly embedded right here in Santa Barbara. And today, we're going to explore a little bit about those roots. I chose today's topic because my discipline has a rich history itself and a significant connection to those roots. I decided to tell you the story today through the perspective of some of the pioneers and divers of that era, and many of them are with us here in this room today. I'm also proud to call them friends. Now, for me, today is really a tribute to a discipline, a profession, and a community that I love and respect. Now, I've always stood in awe of those who came before me, So today, I hope to pay some homage to this. Now, we can't begin to explore all the details of this rich history that we have here in diving, but instead, I chose to take a few areas that are of significance to me, and hopefully they'll be of interest here today to you. Seneca said that men learn while they teach, and it's been a lot of fun and very rewarding preparing for today. So thanks for being here with me. Now, as we before we get into the meat of things here, I look out here and I'm so profoundly aware of how many people have played such an important part in my life. And I'd like to take a moment and acknowledge some of them. Now, your program lists quite a few, so I encourage you to read that. But firstly, my parents, Doris and Cookie, they're all the way with us here from Cape Coral, Florida. And they gave me a... they gave me a loving home close to the ocean back in Long Island, and they blessed me with a great many life experiences growing up on the water there. So thanks, Mom and Dad. The most important person in my world is my wife, Carol, and she's right down here out front, and Carol represents all of the good things in life to me. My two children are here today, Robbie and Dee Dee. They are the most things that I'm most proud of in my life. They actually reluctantly ditched school to be here today. Can you believe that? They're going to sit here quietly while their dad lectures to them. Yeah. Now, this will be a first. I do want to acknowledge the published work of two good friends and local divers. First off, Scrap Lundy wrote the California Abalone Industry, A Patola History. And secondly, Chris Swan, he wrote this book, which was recently released in October here, The History of Oilfield Diving. Both of these books are seminal pieces of work in their respective areas of diving. And they were of great use to me and great resources as I prepared for the talk today. But additionally, both Scrap and Chris were just a phone call away, and they sat and talked with me whenever I needed to clarify things. So thanks, Scrap and Chris, for all of your help. I also want to acknowledge my good friend Steve Barsky, who's in the audience I know today. Steve provided me with many photographs, as well as Richard Hegeman and Peter Holworth. I think Peter's here today. Evie Treen. And Bob Kirby and Bev Morgan, thank you very much for all your help with the photographs and different props. So, lastly, before we move on here, I do want to acknowledge Santa Barbara City College President John Romo. Where's John?
Right here.
John is retiring at the end of June. And John, on behalf of the community, I want to thank you. You've served this community and this college for well over three decades. And we want to thank you for your honesty and your sincerity, but most importantly, your friendship over the years. We wish you luck in retirement. Enjoy those grandkids. Now, if you look on your program and this man bears any resemblance to his youthful diving days, that's because Bob Christensen was one of the early deep diving pioneers here back in the 1960s. Now, Bob is a graduate of Santa Barbara High School. He's also an alumnus of USC. He served in the United States Navy in the underwater demolition team, which is today is the US Navy SEAL team. Are there any SEALs out there in the audience? No? I didn't hear a hoo-yah, so okay. All right. Now, Bob, he left a booming commercial diving industry in 1969 to give back to the profession. He joined the late Ramsey Parks here at Santa Barbara City College in the then newly formed Marine Technology Program. Now, Bob was director of the program from 1980 until he retired in 1985. Now, Bob has always been a tremendous resource for me professionally and personally, and preparing for the talk today was no exception. This man is a walking encyclopedia of knowledge and skill, complete with a photographic memory. So, on top of all this, Bob is a true gentleman. Bob, I'm really honored to dedicate this lecture to you here today for all you have done for diving and continue to do for diving and education and the person on the end of the hose. Bob and his wife June are sitting right here. Bob, would you please stand and be acknowledged? Now, as we begin today, this becomes our essential question, and the answers to this essential question are actually embedded in three of our local natural marine resources. And the first is abalone. And you're probably saying, well, what's an abalone? Most people know, but it's a single-shell mollusk. There's one right here, actually. And they cling to local rocky reefs underwater. Now, you may say, what's a mollusk? Well, Jenny will tell you. But I'll tell you in plain English. It's kind of a giant underwater snail, and we eat it. Now, our second resource is a resource that some have said we can't live with, but we certainly can't live without offshore oil. It's been part of the Santa Barbara culture for many thousands of years, and we do rely on it. Probably our most appreciated resource, however, is the inherent beauty of our Santa Barbara Channel Islands, and you saw a little bit of that in the video that we shot out offshore there. We all love to dive and play in our own backyard, don't we? Yeah. Now, my research into diving and abalone had me kind of backpedaling here all the way back into the Chumash period. So I paid a visit to one of our local treasures here in Santa Barbara, the Santa Barbara Museum of Natural History. And there I talked with the curator of anthropology, Dr. John Johnson. Now, John provided some tremendous insight into the early use of these three resources by the true native Santa Barbarans, the Chumash Indians.
We can tell that abalone has been used here for many thousands of years. There was a wide variety of things that were made from abalone shells. First of all, the whole shells themselves were used as dishes, and sometimes they would plug up the holes in the edge of the shell with tar, you know, so they would hold water. The shell was also used to make fish hooks, and you find lots of abalone fish hooks in the Chumash region and on the Channel Islands. 11,000 years ago or so, people are using marine resources. They're harvesting abalone, they're harvesting some of the other shellfish from around the shore. And they continue to do so all down to the time that Europeans arrived. They realized it was a valuable trade item. And so there's a whole variety of ornaments that were used by Chumash Indians and both as necklaces and also regalia.
Now, a revelation for me in my research here was I discovered some work done in 1986 by Kennedy, who suggested that the Chumash were the first to dive for abalone here in Santa Barbara. And he made this discovery based on the presence of exostoses in the auditory ear canals that they uncovered in the skulls from the remains of some burial sites. Now, exostoses is a bony growth of the ear canal, and it happens from repeated immersion in cold water over time, and many local surfers and divers are afflicted with this. Now, the Chumash, they obviously free dove for abalone. They didn't have compressed air back then. And the tar that John talked about in the plugging up the holes here in the shell came from the natural oil seeps. Now, they also used this tar to seal between the planks of their tomals, which are their canoes that they used to paddle out to the islands. So, for many thousands of years, man has relied on these three natural resources, abalone, oil, and the Channel Islands. Now, the Japanese, skipping ahead a couple hundred years, I know my colleagues in anthropology are going, oh, wow, that's a quick one. going up to 1898, the Japanese introduced compressed air to the California abalone fishery. And I asked my good friend Scrap Lundy, who is the reigning expert on the abalone industry, to shed a little bit of light on that area for us.
Well, historically, the Japanese started heavy gear diving for abalone in 1898, and they brought it from Japan, where they had been doing it for probably 20 years prior to that. And so the Japanese found very quickly that you could not skin dive for abalone as they did in Japan because of the cold water here. So they imported the heavy gear helmet of the British design and improved it a little bit themselves. And as time went on, people like Kirby Morgan and others would modify the Japanese helmets, and without their having introduced them originally in 1898, it would have been very difficult for these advancements in diving to occur had not the Japanese introduced them in such a large way.
Now, folks, the significance of the Japanese contributions to diving by introducing compressed air to the abalone fishery in 1898 cannot be overstated. And you can see coming out on stage here right now is an actual rendition of the original Japanese abalone gear. And this is an authentic piece of equipment. That's a live, breathing human being inside there. Happens to be, I hope he's going to be, we got air going through that hose, don't we? I hope. That's one of our Marine Tech graduates, Mr. Zeke Bass. And that helmet he's wearing, he's going to pry an abalone off the ceiling. Well, look at that. They suck onto the stage pretty hard, so you're going to have to pry pretty hard. There he goes. Oh, okay. He's got it. All right. Look at that. Awesome. And he puts it into his abalone bag. And you see he's got these weighted shoes on and this gear, and it really wasn't made for walking in auditoriums. It's quite heavy. And he's got some big lead weights on here. Weigh about 65 pounds, the weights. The helmet's made of copper. This weighs 32 pounds, so just the helmet and the weights, we got 100 pounds, and the shoes, 17 pounds each. These guys were tough back then, weren't they? Now, they didn't have communications back then, so I don't know how we're going to talk to this guy, but we got to get this helmet off him, so let's go ahead and pop this helmet off here and see if there's anybody inside. Ooh, here we go. Okay, watch your head there. There's Zeke Bass, ladies and gentlemen. Now, the dress he's wearing here kept him dry when he would be down diving. It's sealed at the cuffs right here, and it would keep the water totally out of the suit, okay, most of the time. So he would wear long woolen underwear under here, and these Japanese divers, they could stay down underwater for long periods of time, and it was actually quite an effective piece of gear that they introduced from Japan. So this helmet from Tokyo, Japan, courtesy of Scrap Lundy, and I think Bob Benton, are you in the audience here someplace, Bob? Is Bob here? Well, maybe not. But these are his weights, a famous local abalone diver. Well, what do you think of that, Zeke?
That was great.
Andy Warhol was right, wasn't he?
Yes, he was.
Everybody's famous for 15 minutes. So it's you and me. This is our 15 minutes.
Sounds good.
All right. Okay, Nick, you take him back down there. He's wearing those brown chafing pants there, too, to prevent the suit from actually getting punctured. Okay, now... Roy Hattori was one of the Japanese abalone divers. At age 89, he is the only surviving member of the original Japanese abalone fleet. And what's significant to note about Roy Hattori was that he discovered the white abalone here in Santa Barbara. And I asked Scrap, who knows Roy well, where's Scrap? Are you here today, Scrap? There he is. Scrap is going to talk, he talked to Roy. Up north, he knows him well, and I asked him to tell us a little bit about Roy so we can kind of get to know him here. Roy couldn't come down.
Roy Hattori is one of the finest men I've ever met, and he started abalone diving in 1937, and he volunteered to do it so his older brother could continue going to school. In 1939, Roy came down to Santa Barbara on his mother boat, towing his dive boat, just to check out the area from Point Conception to Santa Barbara because the Japanese had never been here before. And while here, he went diving, and it has to have been, at Leadbetter Beach. And he found these different shaped shells. So he harvested a few and took them back to Monterey and showed them to a famous and noted shell collector by the name of Sorensen. Well, Sorensen sends it in to the National Museum, the Smithsonian, and they were in fact undiscovered. He presented them as if he had found them, so they were called Haliotis Sorensena instead of Hattori, after Roy Hattori, who found them. And I actually wrote the Smithsonian trying to set the record straight, and they said, though, so many years have gone by, we're not going to make a change. That was the prejudice of the day, is where it came from. Sorensen would not give Roy credit for what he had found.
Now, sadly, folks, the Japanese-American era of abalone diving came to an abrupt halt with their internment into camps with the U.S. entrance into World War II. And this was done an executive order signed in February 1942 by President Roosevelt. Now, ultimately, over time, two-thirds of all the abalone taken in California came from right here in Santa Barbara. That's due to its abundance at the Channel Islands. Now, most of the abalone was processed out at Stern's Wharf. Barney Clancy, the Pierce brothers were some of the names of that era. Now, the fishery has been closed for quite some time, since 1997, and it's the exception of freediving up in Northern California, but it's still strictly regulated up there. Now, the recent decline of abalone is due to a myriad of factors, some of them man-made, some of them natural, and it's actually quite controversial, so we'll just leave it at that. Now, what's all this fuss over abalone about? Is it really worth it? I don't know. Yeah, they're saying, okay. Well, we start off by free diving down, and this is a diver in Northern California, and he's popping an abalone off. They actually suck down to the rock, and they must take the meat now out of the shell. It's actually quite messy. Then they slice it into quarter-inch steaks, and they pound it out to tenderize it with these mallets. And you can bread it, and you can saute it, and it's actually quite tasty. Now, abalone was once as abundant as hamburger was, or is, in stores and restaurants. Today, it's a scarcity, and it's a sought-after delicacy. This is a menu from Café del Sol in Montecito, and you can see 1970, a plate of abalone was $5.50. Now, recently, Carol and I, we went to Café del Sol, and, yeah, I ordered a plate, and, you know, she reached across the table and slapped me. I ended up with the Montecito pepper steak instead. Still okay. Now, over time, the gear that these divers used, the Japanese introduced the heavy gear, and you can see in this photograph, there's a young lad, Handelman, 17 years old in that picture, I believe. He was a good-looking guy back then, 1950s. They dove all heavy gear for the abalone here in Santa Barbara. They could stay warm. That was the ticket. They liked it. As they moved into the 1960s, though, the gear that the divers used down south, diving for abalone down there, was a lighter weight gear, a full face mask gear. They could cover more ground, and they still kept dry by using these rubber Aquala dry suits that you see in that picture there. And that's actually, I checked with Bev on this, Bev Morgan, who's here. And this was a Scuba Pro style mask. It wasn't really popular in the day, but nonetheless, this is a rendition of the gear that they used. You can see he still has his abalone catch bag, but they could cover more ground, and they started to need to as the beds became more scarce. And moving into the 1970s, hookah gear became popular, and a lot of the divers in the audience are familiar with hookah gear, but for those of us that are not, most everybody's familiar with scuba gear. We stick this regulator, this thing in our mouth, and we inhale, and we get air, and we breathe. And the air comes from a tank we carry on our back. Well, the divers, the abalone divers, they couldn't, you know, dive with a scuba tank and be down for an hour. They had to stay down for hours at a time. So they ran this hose all the way up to the surface, and they fed it with compressed air from an air compressor. So this gear was a lot easier to work with. It's actually still used today in the urchin fishery. And they were extremely mobile, but the neat thing was you could just take an off-the-shelf scuba mask and a regulator and become an abalone diver pretty quickly. Now, that's the evolution of the gear that these guys use. But what's significant for us to note here, folks, is that throughout all of this process right here, all of these decades of diving, Santa Barbara had a tremendous pool of very resourceful, hardworking, and talented divers. Now, abalone divers back in the day, they all possessed three very important traits. Firstly, they were not afraid of hard work in harsh environments. Secondly, they were very resourceful working with their gear. They knew their diving gear, their equipment. They also knew marine engines, compressors, seamanship, and boating. And lastly, probably of most importance, at least in my eyes, is they understood that diving is just the means to get to a work site, to get a job done, and make a profit. So the abalone divers, they knew what was going on. And this positioned Santa Barbara very strategically in the evolution which is about to come. Now, turning the clock a little bit into the 1900s, right around the early 1900s, the turn of the last century, Summerland, just down the road here, was the site of the world's first offshore oil wells. And you can see these piers, they're moving out into the offshore waters. Well, the oil here in Santa Barbara, it oozes up from the ground. Natural gas bubbles up from the seafloor. So I guess the oil companies must have figured, geez, if we want to get oil, I guess we should probably drill in a place where it oozes from the ground. and where it bubbles from the seafloor. So they soon found themselves moving from the cliffs of Summerland into the offshore waters. Which brings us into 1929, we had the world's first offshore oil dive naturally take place off of the Rincon. 1929, a gentleman by the name of Rigdon Crawford, and he dove from this little pier over on the right-hand side that was not too far off the beach. Now, what's interesting to note here is that Rigdon did not use the traditional abalone helmets that you saw Zeke coming out on stage with, the lighter weight helmet. He used this big old thing right here that everybody's familiar with. This is the U.S. Navy Mark V helmet. And that was introduced in about 1915. And that's what Rigdon used to make his dive. Now, that's a very heavy piece of gear to work in. The abalone divers, they shied away from that for obvious reasons. Difficult to move around in, very cumbersome, and you couldn't be real effective with it. But nonetheless, Rigdon made his dive with that helmet. Now, the takeaway for us here, folks, is you look at the beach, you look at that rig, the continental shelf gets very close to Santa Barbara, so the water here gets deeply, very, very quickly. So soon, the oil companies, as they moved offshore, they found themselves needing to dive in 250 feet of water, very close to the beach. Skip ahead a couple years to 1956, enter into the diving picture, Associated Divers. Now, Associated Divers was basically a conglomerate of different divers from Southern California construction area. Then we had local abalone divers who started to migrate into the construction work and the oil field work that was being done at the time. And these guys were highly paid, and rightly so, as they routinely dove beyond 200 feet using compressed air. Now, there's a lot of divers in the audience, I know, and you're probably sitting there going, oh my God, they must have been like silly putty down there. Well, yes, several of them were, for the most part. Now, these guys developed a high tolerance for a thing we call nitrogen narcosis. Now, when we go diving, without getting too deep into it here for you non-divers, we have air, oxygen, and nitrogen. And the nitrogen component of the air, it's a bad thing. It's just along for the ride. We don't use it metabolically, but if we breathe it under high pressures, it actually becomes narcotic. So in essence, these guys from Associated would be diving like after having a few drinks at Harry's Plaza Cafe. So yeah, they'd be down diving, and that's fine if you're at the bar, a couple drinks at Harry's is not necessarily a big deal. Go diving, and it is a big deal. You can't get a lot done. Makes the dive unsafe, and it clouds their judgment, slows their reaction time. So these guys were compensated pretty well for what they did, and they're actually very good at it. Don't get me wrong. For example, Charles Isbell, who was one of the early Associated Divers, he made $90,000 in 1957. Yeah, that's a pretty good chunk of change, even by today's standards. So I plugged that number into our inflation calculator. What do you think it came up to be? About $644,000. Yeah. So anyway, this diving beyond 250 feet, they were pretty much at a technological standstill now. Can't go any deeper. The oil companies knew vast reserves awaited out beyond 250 feet, and they wanted to get to them, but they couldn't. This diver here, a lot of you old-timers may recognize him. This is the late Ted Benton in the picture. This is Bob's brother. Now, we kind of get to the crux of our presentation here today. November of 1962, a bold and risky dive was made by one of our Santa Barbara abalone divers, Dan Wilson. Now, Dan was an abalone diver and a processor. He had a facility over on, I believe it was Haley Street or Gutierrez Street. And he demonstrated that divers could work beyond 300 feet using a breathing gas other than this nasty Harry's Plaza Cafe effect air, okay? So this helium that he would use, he took the nitrogen out and put helium in. Well, the helium is non-narcotic, so we wouldn't have this effect. Now, Dan did this so that he could position himself for the upcoming deep water work that he knew was just around the corner. He didn't do it just to go out and be cool. Okay, so he knew that if he could demonstrate this to the oil companies, he'd be in a pretty good position. Now, Danny didn't invent oxyhelium diving. Okay, he learned about it while he was down south at the Sparling School of Deep Sea Diving down in Wilmington. That was taught by the late E.R. Cross, Navy master diver. And so Danny took this oxyhelium gas and he used it and he went out and made a dive. Now, up until this point, only the U.S. Navy had been able to perform such dives. Navy had been doing heliox dives for quite some time. Actually, 1919, the gas was introduced by Professor Elihu Thompson, who was a physicist. But the Navy, this is a Navy helmet, and the Navy, in order to dive helium, they had to use an even heavier piece of gear than this, ridiculously piece of heavy gear. It was this helmet, basically, with a big canister strapped on the back to help purify the air that they were, excuse me, the gas that they were breathing and recycle it. The helmet itself weighed 93 pounds. Yeah. And then you have a 64-pound weight belt or above, and you got the shoes, the dress. They had to winch the divers off the stage. So for obvious reasons, nobody did any oxyhelium diving using the Navy gear. Now, what's significant for us to note here from this point forward? This dive by Dan Wilson, this 400-foot dive that he did, was the catalyst for what I call the Santa Barbara helium rush, as technology rapidly evolved from this point forward. Now, Danny did his dive on November 3rd, 1962. It was off the east end of Santa Cruz Island right out here. And he did it in relative secrecy. He used the boat, the local boat Rio Janeiro, which was down here in the harbor. It was captained by a local skipper, Glenn Miller. A lot of you old-timers will remember Glenn. Now, this was done in relative secrecy by Danny. He didn't want to alert the other divers as to what he was up to. So he went out with a small crew of divers, including his wife, Dorothy, and they went out and they pulled this dive off. He took his abalone helmet, and this is his actual abalone helmet right here. It was a surprise that was just sort of dropped in my lap here about an hour ago. His son, Dan, is here with us today. Dan, would you please stand and be acknowledged here while... Dan, this is... Thank you, Dan. This is Dan Wilson's son, Dan. Danny passed away tragically. We lost him in August last year. So this is the original helmet that he made this dive with right here, a piece of history. He took this helmet, and he took it over to Santa Barbara Radiator Shop. Okay? He didn't want to dive that Mark V helium helmet. That's not going to work. I am not going to do that. Well, by that time, we know scuba gear had become popular in the 50s. So what Dan did, he's a pretty forward-thinking dude. He took this regulator here, and he took it to Santa Barbara Radiator Shop, and he said, I need to put this inside here. I need an adapter because I want to breathe off this inside my helmet. Well, he did that, and they modified this helmet. They soldered a little fitting on here on the back, and that way he could access his heliox supply from the surface. So they soldered this fitting in, and he mounted this thing in his helmet, and they fed it with helium, and at depth, he would simply lean forward and breathe this oxyhelium mixture, which was supplied in high-pressure cylinders down on the up, kept on the surface. So they sent it down, and he just breathed, and he pulled off this 400-foot dive. Just incredible. An ingenious type of invention. Rather crude, if it were by today's standards, but nonetheless, it worked. Now, when Danny did this dive, he had safety divers in the water, and they were on scuba. He left the surface at 3 o'clock, and he was back on deck by 4:30. So a pretty long dive because the majority of time was spent decompressing in the water column. He didn't spend any time at depth. He just went down, did what we call a bounce dive, and it was a pretty risky dive because he did all in-water decompression, and he had no recompression chamber. Our divers know that, you know, we've got to have a recompression chamber on board. Well, he didn't have one. Now, this was a pretty historic event right here, the pretty big catalyst. And I asked Bob Christensen to summarize the significance of this event to the big picture in the evolution of underwater technology.
Heavy gear was king in 1960, 61, 62. That's what we dove, air heavy gear. Danny Wilson came along in the fall of 62, actually winter of 62, made a 400-foot helium oxygen dive using modified heavy gear, opened the eyes to a lot of people. The industry thought he was nuts, thought he was going to kill himself. The offshore oil thought, hey, we're going to get some bottom time and some deep water work out of this. And they almost immediately gave him a contract. He put together the gear, trained a few people very rudimentarily, and pulled off his contract. So then there was a scramble for everybody to get into mixed gas. Okay, well, mixed gas allows you to go deeper, stay longer, and breathe helium oxygen. Okay, that's a big chill factor. The heliox is very cold to breathe. The deep water is very cold. The decompression times are longer. Got to be a matter of exposure. Initially, we were doing surface dives on mixed gas down below 400 feet. That's just, today, that's ridiculous. You needed a way to get there and do the work and be protected. And so diving bells came along in about 64, the initial one. And the development of the diving bell was sort of a domino effect. You had to have gear that would fit in the bell. Heavy gear didn't work, so I had to go to a lightweight gear. That started the development of some workable lightweight equipment. And that evolution has continued until today. We have very sophisticated bells and lightweight equipment.
Now, as I mentioned, sadly, we lost Danny in August of this year. And again, Dan, thanks for being here. He's all the way here from Montana. I'm still tingling over the fact that he brought a piece of history. I emailed him in Montana, and I asked him, I would love to have some pictures of this helmet for the presentation. Well, I never heard back from him. He decided he's going to come with the helmet. So. Now, Dan Wilson partnered immediately after that dive with Lad Handelman. Toot the horn, Lad. You up there? He's up there. Whitey Steffens, who's over here, and Kenny Elms, who owned the fuel dock. Now, Laddie and Whitey, they were abalone divers, and they partnered with Danny and Kenny Elms, who owned the fuel lock down in the harbor. And they each put in $10,000, and they started a company called General Offshore Divers. And the rest is pretty much history, as we'll find out. Now, this Santa Barbara helium rush that we had here opened the door for deep diving exploration beyond 300 feet. Now, again, the big advantage of using the oxyhelium here is that we have no Harry's Plaza Cafe effect at depth, right? Yeah, okay, the helium is non-narcotic. So the diver can perform this dive with a clear head and function much more efficiently. They can do work on the fly. They can change things. This became a huge, huge advantage to all the oil companies and all the construction firms that needed to do any kind of deep water work. So very significant in our industry. But like all modes of diving, there are trade-offs between these different modes. That we introduce helium, but we introduce a whole host of other factors here. And we're going to spend just a couple minutes talking about that. Now, a lot of divers in the audience, but a lot of non-divers, and whenever I tell anybody what I do, they always say, well, what about the bends? What about them? Well, when we go diving, the inert component of the breathing mixture that we're inhaling, in case of air, it would be the nitrogen. In the case of this oxyhelium, it would be the helium. Well, I said that stuff is just along for the ride, right? Well, it is actually absorbed when we go diving, a lot of it. It goes into solution in our tissues. It gets dissolved into our tissues. The deeper we go down, the longer we stay down, the more of this inert gas we absorb in our body's tissues. Well, that's all fine and good, provided that when we come up, the reverse process must happen. So we must have this gas that's dissolved in our tissues, come back from our tissues, go back into our bloodstream, okay, and then we exhale it. We want to breathe it out on the way up. So we got to have this process take place slowly. So we ascend slowly, and periodically, the deep diver will need to stop in the water column to allow this process to take place. And we call this stage decompression. Now, problems happen when we release this pressure too soon or too quick, and we form bubbles. This gas comes out of solution in the form of bubbles. Much the same as I've got a bottle of soda water here, right? There's gas dissolved in here in solution, okay? And it's under pressure. So if I were to take the top off real quick, you ready? The gas comes out of solution, and we have bubbles. Yeah, I knew that was gonna happen, but we've got bubbles, okay? So there you go. Your bubbles, if this happens in your body, bad things happen. These bubbles, they basically sludge up your blood. Not only does your stage get wet, but your blood sludges up. Now, these bubbles, they can lodge in a variety of different areas and cause a whole host of physiological signs and symptoms, some of them rather dramatic. For example, a bubble can lodge against your spinal cord or migrate up to the brain, and you can have very, very bad things happen, okay, even all the way up to death. So we definitely want to avoid this. Now, to further illustrate this, I did a little experiment here using the chamber we have in Marine Tech at City College, and I actually bent a couple of cups of Jell-O. I didn't ask for student volunteers or anything, but I wanted to show you what happens here. So I took some Jell-O and I pressurized it down the chamber to 200 feet. Let's take a look. To illustrate what happens to a diver's body, I pressurized several cups of Jell-O to 200 feet in a recompression chamber. This packs more molecules of gas into the semi-liquid gelatin, much the same as our bodies absorb nitrogen or helium during a dive. The longer and deeper one dives, the more gas is absorbed into the tissues. If we ascend too soon or too fast, the dissolved gas comes out of solution in the form of bubbles in our blood and body tissues. These bubbles disrupt normal cellular function and trigger a variety of physiological problems called the bends or decompression sickness.
You can see the bubbles beginning to form and enlarge on the surface. This one here in particular is sausage-shaped, which is more indicative of what we see in decompression sickness. Bubbles are not typically round in decompression sickness. They take various different forms, but typically sausage-shaped when they're inside blood vessels. And you can see there's some other ones here that are beginning to form. And as more bubbles around form, they actually coagulate and form bigger bubbles.
And I mentioned there's trade-offs here with using this oxyhelium mixture. And decompression sickness is an inherent hazard, and it's always going to be there. So we always got to contend with that. But Bob Christensen talked about the big chill. When we breathe this helium, it's very cold. And I've got to do a little experiment here. I need a student volunteer. Any City College students here in the audience on the aisles here? No? Well, I'm going to have to pick a live person. Oh, there's one right there. Okay. All right. And what's your name?
I'm Zach.
Are you a Marine Tech student?
Oh, Zach's a Marine Tech. And
where do you live, Zach?
Where am I from? Yeah. I'm from Vancouver.
Vancouver?
Yeah.
All the way up in Canada. Okay, Zach. Well, are you a first-year student?
Yes, I am.
Cool. All right. Well, I'm on sabbatical leave this year. That's why I don't know this guy. Okay. Well, Zach, what I have in this bottle, and you are a City College student, right?
Yes, I am.
Well, Zach, I'm going to have you breathe. So I have some oxyhelium here in the cylinder, and I'm just going to have you breathe some of it here, and you're going to get cold really, really quickly, okay? Just seal this mask over your face and just keep breathing. Now, the reason I asked if Zach is a student here, because it says on this bottle here, it says, caution, breathing gas other than air. That way, if anything bad happens to him, he's covered under the City College insurance policy. The Board of Trustees are cringing over here. What's it going to do? Well, you getting cold there, Zach? Yeah, getting a little bit cold? Yeah, okay. Well, good. Well, how about taking and reading that slide up there?
Follow the yellow brick road.
Very good. Say it again.
Follow the yellow brick road.
Take another hit. All right. Obviously, the divers had to contend with this voice issue because the helium travels across our vocal cords some 6 times faster than it does in normal air. Now, another trade-off that they had was the cost of this gas, too. About 30 cents a breath to conduct a dive at 400 feet like Danny was doing back in 62. This is in today's dollars. So, your student ID, we've added about $3 worth there, Zach. So that'll be on your account. We'll put a hold on your transcripts and all that stuff. Yeah. Okay. All right. So we associate normally oxygen with the heliox diving as a good thing. And we need oxygen to live, don't we? Well, yeah. We need about 16% on the surface. Well, too much of this oxygen, though, can be a bad thing, such as when we go deep diving with it. Because of the pressure of the oxygen at depth, it can cause a condition we call oxygen toxicity. It's a very feared condition. And the gas divers of the day, they had to contend with this. So we will actually reduce the percentage of oxygen in the breathing mixture. For example, here, Zach, you were breathing 18% there, not a full 21%. Now, if you get this oxygen toxicity at depth, it produces a variety of signs and symptoms, and usually they're typically pretty dramatic. Convulsive seizures is usually the one of the ones that hits you. Now, obviously, if this happens to you at depth and you're diving, it's very bad, very serious. Now, on January 31st, 1964, Danny Wilson was out here off the coast in Santa Barbara, and they were gas diving. General Offshore and the crew, they were out. Danny was down, and he went unconscious due to this oxygen toxicity. Now, the standby diver on the job that day is this gentleman down front here, Whitey Steffens. It's his responsibility as a standby diver to jump into action. Now, like Danny, Whitey was trained down at the Sparling School of Deep Sea Diving, so he had an intricate knowledge of mixed gas diving, and he knew what was happening. Now, Whitey lives above me here on the Mesa. He's been retired recently, celebrated his 60th anniversary this past year. He was kind enough to meet with me and have a cup of coffee one Saturday morning, and I asked him about that dive.
Well, I was standby diver when he was down, so I was already dressed in. Fine, going down to hit bottom, and he was talking all right, and then pretty soon he wasn't talking. We had no communication. I jumped in and went down his hose as a descending knife, because that's going to take me right to him. When I got him, he was laying over on the bottom, and just dark blue in the face port, and I knew he was pretty well out. So I immediately put him on some open circuit to flush the helmet out, set the two valves, his exhaust valve as well as his air coming in. Then I got him up to his first stop. He's still out, but he's opening a blink of his eyes, but the color is coming back a little bit. And then I had him bring him up to the next stop, and I'm right there beside him. Got in the next stop, he was on that for about, I don't think more than 3 or 4 minutes. You ever see a guy go crazy? Neither did I. But I'm not a weakling. I couldn't hold him. Oh, his face, his eyes got that big, and he started climbing. He was going to the surface. Yeah, I tried to stop him. I couldn't. I figured he was dead. The guys had him up at the water and he's out, and they're trying to pick him up and they can't quite do it. And Mitch, he went down that ladder and he grabbed Danny and got him over his shoulder. Hang on, he just come up that ladder just like nothing, I'm told, because I was down there yet.
They were still decompressing, huh?
Yeah. So they got him up in the water, and Laddie was in the tank decompression from previous dive. So he was in the back chamber, and he had the front one open so they can get him in. I also had Lina Weaver, our medical guy, I had him come out. Before I went to water, I said, get hold of Lina Weaver and get him out here in a chopper, which they did, because I didn't know exactly what we were going to do. At any rate, he came out fine.
You saved his life.
Well, maybe I didn't. I did get him off of the bottom and get him up. The guys on the top saved his life. They got him into that chamber, just ripped, shit or bust.
That, folks, is what I call a heroic dive. Now, had General Offshore and Whitey Steffens not responded the way they did that day, our industry would have likely taken a very, very different direction. Now, Dan Wilson spent some 18 hours in a recompression chamber in order to survive that mishap. An investigation into the accident soon discovered the cause of the problem, and the gas that they had ordered from the gas supply company was improperly mixed. They had thought they were diving 18% heliox, when in fact they were diving 20%. Now that mere 2% difference at that depth was enough to bring on this feared oxygen toxicity hit. And this experience really had a profound impact on Danny, and he never did much deep gas diving after that. He was actually too busy developing the other aspects of General Offshore that Bob Christensen talked about. They were building the Prisma diving bell. They had to build new diving gear. He had multiple contracts to manage, and he was a pretty busy character after that. So he focused on expanding his company's services and equipment. Now, what's really important for us to note here, folks, is that this dive done November 3rd, 1962, by Danny Wilson, Hugh Dan Wilson, by the way, is his full name, was the catalyst for three significant things in the evolution of underwater technology. Firstly, newer equipment needed to be developed to conduct these deeper operations, such as the gas diving manifolds. We needed lighter weight diving gear to get out of the bell that he built, the Prisma diving bell. All this gear needed to be developed. The second thing was, we suddenly had competing local companies trying to catch up to General Offshore divers. They had come in and they dethroned Associated Divers, the King Kongs of air diving at that point, the Titans. They were only acting in town. Suddenly General Offshore was now the big ticket. So Associated was struggling to catch up, but then there were other divers, without getting into names and things, that were starting to get into the picture. Murray Black from DiveCom was one of them. Now, the third thing that happened as a result of this helium rush was that a massive worldwide labor demand was created for all this new deep water exploration work, which could now take place. Okay, so suddenly here we have these Santa Barbara collar copper abalone divers who suddenly became white collar businessmen. And we had a spirit of entrepreneurism suddenly evolve here in Santa Barbara, and it just blossomed from right here, and it went out to the Gulf of Mexico, it went to the North Sea, and it went to many other areas internationally, as we have now had a new market-driven underwater economy. And it was a really fantastic and exciting time in the history of diving. Now, like others in the commercial diving industry, Bob Kirby and Bev Morgan, they're with us here today, they were abalone divers who made the transition into commercial oil field diving. Now, Kirby, the gentleman over here on this side of the screen, he worked over Associated Divers. Now, Associated is playing catch-up at this point. They got to get into this heliox rush. So they asked Bob to design a helmet that they could compete with this guy here so that they could get into the helium act here. Well, Bob designed this helmet sitting right on the stage right here. This is an authentic Kirby Morgan gas hat, and it's ingenious. And Zach, you would have liked it, because instead of 30 cents a breath, Bob took that gas and he recirculated it so it could be breathed over. He cleansed it through this carbon dioxide absorbent canister here, and we could recycle it rather than exhaust it out into the water column. So it was similar in concept to that bulky 93-pound Navy helmet, but much lighter and much more efficient. This thing does not weigh 93 pounds. So that's what Bob was doing at Associated. Now, he met Bev Morgan in 1965, and Bev had been building lightweight fiberglass masts for several years down in the Southern California area for the Newport Beach divers. Now, Bev is sitting right down here in front, and this man has an intuitive knowledge of diving and equipment. Well, him and Kirby met in 1965, and they've decided to form a partnership. Partnership called Kirby Morgan. Today it's Kirby Morgan Dive Systems. Their first shop was out here at Santa Barbara Airport. And it's important for us to note here, the takeaway for us is that these two guys, Bob Kirby and Bev Morgan, changed diving forever.
I started making the helium helmets about the time that I met Bev Morgan. And so we went to work together, and after 1 month, we determined that we were both compatible in the shop. I don't know that I ever could have run into somebody that was more knowledgeable than Bev Morgan, easier to get along with. Every day we would come across new ideas and new ways of doing things, innovative things that would just blow your mind away.
And Kirby and I, you're talking about the climate in the shop in those days, Every other day we had somebody calling us up to buy us out.
I don't think we could have pulled it off if we weren't divers. It's easier to train ourselves to mold the fiberglass and get Dick Quinton to do the machine work than it was to learn how to be divers.
And having a kind of a sense of what divers want and how to improve things, it's a constant improving situation. Well, we're up to number 77 in design now on helmets. Well, 77 in 40 years means a couple of improvements every year. We're still using the same gear that we used 40 years ago, that Kirby and I sat down and built 40 years ago and replaced the heavy gear. 40 years. That gear is going to be used 50 years from now.
You can see here comes out on stage here the latest off the production line from Kirby Morgan Dive Systems. This is the Superlight 77 dive helmet. And it's significantly lighter than the traditional heavy gear that was used back in the day. But this is the most modern, up-to-date piece of gear. And it actually, I don't even think this helmet's been dove yet, actually. Now, what's unique about this gear is you can see the diver's pretty mobile. So he can work in and out of a dive bell with that. And he has a hose he's towing back behind him that feeds his air supply to him. And he has great communications. You can hear him breathing over the comms. He's got a scuba bottle on the back right there. That scuba bottle is his reserve gas supply. We call it a bailout bottle. And it's kind of a Darth Vader looking kind of thing, isn't it? Yeah.
I am your father.
Ah. I am your father, huh? Okay. Now, the suit he's wearing is very different than the standard dry dresses that were worn back in the day. That's a hot water suit, and they use that working out of the diving bells. And instead of keeping the diver dry, we just give him an underwater jacuzzi. We send down nice hot water to him, and it keeps the diver nice and toasty. So that helmet has a high degree of redundancy. It's one of the best breathing helmets, or the best breather on the market, and just a fantastic piece of gear. Now, what's the takeaway here? Patrick Wilson, thank you very much for that demonstration. There he is. Now, Patrick is he's one of our Marine Tech graduates. He's actually our lab technician who's responsible for taking care of this gear, so he was just testing it out walking up there. He's also a veteran of the United States Army Rangers and served us well in Afghanistan. So thank you, Patrick, for your service. Service to your country and service to Marine Tech. Now, what's important for us to note here, folks, about the Kirby Morgan era is that they became, and they are, a household word in commercial diving to this day. In essence, they are the Microsoft of the commercial diving industry. That's how big these guys are. They put Santa Barbara on the map as the worldwide leaders to this day in commercial diving equipment. Bob Kirby and Bev Morgan, they started at the airport. They have their research and development facility remains to this day at 425 Garden Street. And they recently added a brand new huge manufacturing plant up in Santa Maria. And this right here is a 1968 cover of Life magazine. So they were interested back then. Now, two local companies of interest that emerged. I said that we had a lot of companies getting in on the act here. Well, Dan Wilson and his company, General Offshore, they were ultimately bought out by Union Carbide to form Ocean Systems. And Whitey Steffen stayed on and ran that. And Dan went down to the Gulf of Mexico and started another company, Subsea International. And Laddie Handelman, he stayed here in Santa Barbara and started a company called CalDive, which eventually evolved into Oceaneering International. Now, CalDive was located out on Stern's Wharf, and Oceaneering, they ultimately moved their corporate headquarters at one point here to Santa Barbara, international headquarters. Now, today, both of these firms, they are publicly traded on the New York Stock Exchange, CalDive and Oceaneering. And they're just but a handful of companies, folks, that emerged out of this area as a result of this helium rush. But many of the players, they all share a connection to the roots of commercial diving, deep water diving here in Santa Barbara. Santa Barbara's Lad Handelman co-founded Oceaneering International in 1969 by merging his company CalDive with two others. Their signature dive helmet was the Rat Hat, built by Bob Ratcliffe, another Santa Barbara abalone diver who also worked with General Offshore. Oceaneering brought access to deeper diving depths with their atmospheric diving suits. UCSB scientists Alice Aldridge and Bruce Robeson used the WASP in 1982. The WASP and gym suits allowed divers to work at depths over 2,000 feet without exposure to the elements or decompression. The arms bell featured a state-of-the-art manipulator system perfected by Scott Millard, another local who later formed Western Space and Marine. The electrohydraulic arm was controlled by an operator inside the bell with a master controller. The slaved arm would mimic the motions of the operator and had a high degree of dexterity. Now, Oceaneering's atmospheric diving division, they opened the deep frontier for diving beyond the physiological limitations of man diving. So suddenly we could now dive past 2,000 feet without exposure to the elements or decompression and be back on deck for lunch. So this deep water technology, I worked with it a lot, was very safe and very efficient, and it became an immediate alternative to deep water mixed gas diving and saturation diving, which was evolving at the point there too. Now, I mentioned in the mid-1960s, there was a huge labor demand. And at the time, the oil companies projected that they would need some 5,000 divers to satisfy the upcoming work requirements of this new exploration that could take place. Now, at the time, there were fewer than 150 nationwide. And where are all these divers going to come from? Now, there were a lot of people involved in this process. I was talking with Kay Alexander from our Board of Trustees earlier, and Kay shared with me that David Potter was one of those individuals. And a whole host of divers and community members, business people, they got together to get the funding, and they established this world-class program here at Santa Barbara City College to help meet those needs. Now, this world-class program here, folks, celebrates its 40th anniversary this year. And the motto of the program, when it was created, was more than just the diver. And rarely does a day go by where I am not reminded of the positive impact this program has had on so very many lives, mine included.
In 1968, the late Ramsey Parks established the Marine Technology Program at Santa Barbara City College. The initial facility was on Nopal Street. Abby Treen reflects on her husband Woody's involvement.
Sid Frank was my my boss's name, and he asked me one day, he said, I need to talk to Woody because we want to start some kind of a vocational training program. So anyway, they got their heads together, and Woody wanted to make really positive that this program from the City College didn't give just an overview of training, that it gave in-depth training so that when the students went out and went to look for a job, they were safe, they knew what they were supposed to do, and they would have a good occupation. And he was so adamant about that. I get goosebumps thinking about it. Because he said, I don't want it what's a crash course. He said, I want it to be a good program. I think that it turned out to be exactly that.
You know, I'm often asked what I think the future of underwater technology will be. And as a technologist, I'm tempted to speculate. But as an educator, I think I'm going to leave that for our students here today to decide. Now, our oceans are the key to life itself. And few people can argue that they are as healthy as they once were. This is a problem for us right now. Okay, and it's going to become even more of a challenge for us as we move into the future. Now, to all of our marine technology students that are out there, you've been left with an industry that is safer, yet just as exciting as it was decades ago. Honor it, take care of each other, and learn from those who came before you. Don't be afraid to take some calculated risks. Think outside the box. Never fear a challenge, and above all, keep learning. To all of our students in the audience today here at Santa Barbara City College, one of the most important things that I've learned from my field time and academic career is that knowledge and long-term learning is not transferred inside the four walls of a school. It is socially constructed by you in phases throughout a lifetime of rich experiences, realistic experiences, with a diversity of people. Now, that's the hallmark of this institution here at Santa Barbara City College in vocational education. As my former boss and mentor, Booker Washington, used to say to me, you'll never know unless you try. Now, to close out our talk here today, we'll review our essential question. And to help us each construct our own individual perspective, I again turn to my community of practice in marine technology.
I think Santa Barbara is connected to the diving industry because of the unique environment that we have here, particularly with the islands. You know, you talk about the history of the offshore industry. It really started with the abalone divers and the guys that were diving here for abalone back in the 50s and the 60s. And that became a very big deal. And that was the breeding grounds for everybody that went off into the offshore industry as far as commercial oil field diving goes today.
Well, I think when you look at a maritime town like Santa Barbara, an active port, and you look at how it's connected to the rest of the world, the most significant contribution this town has made when you glean through all the different historical aspects is the presentation of deep water diving technology and the manufacture of the equipment that allows divers anywhere in the world to do that sort of diving is the most significant historical fact of the town.
Dan Wilson saw an opportunity out here because the diving was all done on air, which was not efficient, and he opened the door. He said, here's an opportunity. I'll find a reasonable, practical way to dive with helium, and he did it. And that was the beginning of helium diving in the commercial world. He also took the next step, which was to develop the first commercial lockout diving bell. You can say, well, someone would have done both of those things, quite true, but he was the first.
Diving technology in Santa Barbara is a critical part of the maritime history. We are so fortunate to have so many of those diving great individuals here locally. And yes, they do walk through our doors daily, and it's really very exciting to be in such a rich community that way.
Divers, because of the nature of the business, obviously they work out of sight of the public. And so in a way, has been somewhat of a, should we say, that profession has not been acknowledged maybe as much as it should have been, but it certainly is very important.
Santa Barbara has such a rich diving community. I mean, you have commercial divers, you have scientific divers, you have underwater photographers like Mike DeGree, you have inventors like Bob Evans and Bev Morgan. So you have a tremendously diverse community of people who are involved with the ocean. Really, probably more than any other city that I know of in the United States, if not the world.
When you look at the last century, when you look at the home of commercial diving, you look to Santa Barbara.
It's been an honor and a pleasure to speak to you here today. Thank you for coming.